sorry, was that an iron tusk dying in the background?
No, that was me groaning from the crap I've been dealing with in school, and with you two not sitting down on the couch. Get your butts down here!
Absolutely not. We're not your personal bitches.
Don't make me get the whip.
Oh, come on. We all know that you don't have one of those.
No, that would be me.
Besides, who needs a whip when all you need is a wooden spoon?
Go cut me a switch.
I have one of those, but I don't think you want to be in the receiving end of that one. Because it's long and sharp.
Ow.
And falling apart. Probably rusted over.
Much like most, Yeah, I'm not even going to finish that. Welcome to the Legend Hunters podcast, everyone. We're faffing about is the nature of the game.
Yes.
Formally, we were going to call this episode 50 Stages of Legend Hunter, but I figured no.
I believe we've already done enough.
Medieval weaponry, that's all.
We've tied up the joke, hogtied it, oiled it down, and given it a good spanking. I think we pretty much ruined the joke.
Yeah.
Anyway. Well, it's been a long while.
Well, it's been 2 weeks as usual.
It feels like a long while.
Ugh, you know what? I don't blame you, because...
Yeah. A lot of crap going on in school.
Yeah, so why don't I go ahead and start off with the school crap?
Go for it.
I got kicked out of a class!
You got kicked out?
Yep, I got forcibly withdrawn.
Why am I not surprised?
Okay, come on.
Low blow, man, low blow.
You've been making a lot of those lately.
Yeah, I know.
Anyway.
So, long story short, professor didn't like my behavior, and she booted me out.
Well, to be fair, the behavior was something that you did highlight beforehand, and it was something that you've been receiving treatment for.
And, yes. And the fact that, again, there's a complete disregard there, which is a load of bullshit.
Yeah, but then again, it was my mentor who convinced her to forcibly withdraw me, so fuck if I know. Anyway, I'm only working on 8 credits.
Unless they're, I'd still fight it unless they're refunding you the tuition.
I have no idea.
I would fight it if they're not refunding you the tuition.
Second I hear from my mentor about the possibilities, then...
I still say you should go talk to the disability folks as far as that's concerned.
Anyway, other than that, I have currently been spending a little too much time with Dark Souls 2.
Yeah, you pretty much grinded through about 2/3 of the game since the last time I saw you play it.
Yeah.
That's an achievement, I gotta say.
And the thing is, I thought that was where the game ended.
Nope, it is not.
Oh, no. Oh, boy.
So, I got a little bit less than 1/3 of the game left, not counting DLC. Let's see, anything else I've been doing? Nope, that's pretty much it, really. I haven't really had much time for other games lately.
And I don't blame you. It's with all the crap that's been going on, I have no right to blame you.
Mm-hmm. So, how are you doing, Legend?
Slightly saner than usual.
Really? You were sane?
Saner.
Oh, that wasn't a low blow? Saying that you're not surprised your maniacal mad scientist friend getting kicked out of a class is one thing, but directly challenging your sanity is another?
We were always challenging his sanity.
I was.
I'm challenging yours sometimes as well.
I believe I am going clinically insane at one point, but anyway.
One of these days I'm just going to get you a straight jacket for your birthday.
No. All things considered, all things said. The week's been fairly uneventful besides the crazy amount of homework that I've been getting. But other than that, just been going over with the GM for Ravenloft and getting the characters ready, because who God knows what's going to happen with this next run.
Word of advice, we'll just say one thing. Winter is coming.
Yeah, and two of us realize we don't have winter clothes at all. So...
enjoy freezing your non-existent testicles off, gentlemen.
Joy. But yeah, other than that, really, the games I've been playing... oldies and oldies. I actually went back again to Skyrim to try other things that I didn't try, like, for instance, anything to do with alchemy.
You know what? That is actually another thing I was doing with was playing Skyrim a little bit. And I discovered Dark Souls has officially ruined me.
Oh, really?
I cannot play Skyrim because...
There's no dodge button?
There's no dodge, there's no... It really feels like there's no combat to it.
It consists of running up to things and bitch-slapping them in the face until they pass out.
Yeah, I even went into third person to try to get the feeling, and it just felt awkward. Yeah, Dark Souls has officially ruined me.
Although, that being said, I'm surprised you didn't go for alchemy earlier back in its heyday, because it apparently was super broken.
It is super broken.
And that's kind of the reason why I stayed away from it.
There is a lot of fun to be had with alchemy, and alchemy in general. So much so that I was actually inspired to try making GURPS alchemy work and see how I can make that work.
Mm-hmm.
Which basically means putting potions and ingredients together and hoping they don't explode.
Remember, I tried to do that build with the GM, and we basically figured out that alchemy in Ravenloft was kind of impossible.
No, it's not impossible. It's just that it's harder.
It
takes more time.
It's time-consuming, and it requires a singular location. You cannot be a traveling alchemist without having lots of money.
Well, for $1,000 you can have a lab, but you need a table. That's the thing.
Well, you need a table. You would need, like, again, you wouldn't... The only way I could see that working feasibly in a travel location is if you have a wagon. And that's where you put all the alchemy stuff behind it.
There is one other way that makes it slightly more viable. And that is with magic. Which is... Okay, you can basically use magic to create reagents that help speed up the process.
Right,
distilling things much, much faster. I did a lot of digging into alchemy. And it is possible. It's just harder. And there are supplements that you can have to this. There's the long and drawn-out process for alchemy, which can basically happen as week progresses. And there's also going out into the field, picking up some herbs, using your herb lord to figure them out, whipping up a quick potion, and then using that.
Right.
But
which is something that I was trying to do.
Well, herb lore is different than alchemy, though.
That is true.
Also, I think when I tried to build my alchemist at first, I didn't have enough points for a lot of the things I wanted to at the beginning. Like, I wanted, like, a horse-drawn carriage that was, like, a portable lab.
You can't have that, but you need to know how to set it up, and if you want to make certain builds at a lower point value, you have to be willing to sacrifice certain things.
Right. I already kind of had set out where, like, the character was kind of wealthy as it was. He was, like a highly respected... scholar at an alchemist college, basically.
Right.
But he got kicked out, so he still had his stuff with him, but he was basically kicked out for
The other thing is that again, if there's a malfunction with alchemy equipment,
it can explode.
Yeah.
Which goes ahead and destroys all the precious equipment that you actually spent money into actually getting.
Yep.
So, again, to me, it didn't seem worth it. Now, of course, Skyrim's alchemy is completely broken beyond all reason.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. And that's part of the fun.
Yeah. Yeah, you play Skyrim to feel overpowered, to feel OP.
Yeah, it was actually coming up with an alchemist build for Skyrim, which basically said, nerf all the stats and just work on alchemy and swinging a little tiny dagger with poison on it. And that is all. And that would be all.
With a combination of, typically your choice of enchanting and alchemy, you can basically break the game by constantly going back between by drinking potions, enchanting equipment, and then making better potions, which make better equipment, and essentially stack on the cycle to the point where you have stupid amounts of damage from poison.
Oh yeah,
like I want to say quintillions or quadrillions of points of damage.
I think the reason why I got sick of Skyrim is because I was so tired of being OP.
Well, considering that Dark Souls has been giving me quite a hard time recently, I had to go back to something a little more laid back.
Yeah, I tried to do my whole build that we were trying to work on before, and I was like, this is boring. Let me try to replay one of my OP builds. I went back to my Nightblade build, and yeah, I just basically murdered all of Skyrim in an afternoon.
I don't condone murder.
It was very enjoyable.
And then back to the sausage grind.
Yep.
Where are you at now in Dark Souls, anyway?
Me?
Dark Souls 2, 0.
Well, I have just gotten through the Dragon's Eyrie, and I am now currently going into the Giant's Memory.
By the way, that Dragon's Eyrie looks scary as shit.
It is! You have to fight... Let's see, before you get there, you go through this... I forget what it's called, but... It's like a lab place or something. And the second you walk in there, there's a giant bone dragon.
Oh.
That comes to life, attacks, then dies. It is an epic set piece.
And
it can also one-shot you.
Of course.
So you
Dragons and Dark Souls are not to be trifled.
Beginner's trap.
It's a beginner's trap is what it is. You go through that, you have to use a fragrant branch of yore to petrify an ogre.
Fuck that.
To pass through.
Double fuck that.
And then...
Which is guarding a giant basilisk.
Triple times 10 fuck that!
You actually...
Which leads to a hallway with an enhanced undead and two more giant ogres.
Yeah. One is in a cave.
Nope. I am getting out of here as quickly as I can.
Also, there's two bonfires in the place. One is hidden in the, one's hidden behind a hidden door, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And what you have to do is you have to go through one of the doors, go around a whole bunch of stuff, walk tiptoe past an ogre, and then you have to have another ogre break down the wall in front of you, which kind of killed me, and then you gotta run past him to get into the foggy, to fight a giant dragon.
Drake.
It's called the Guardian Dragon, but...
Which is not, because it's a drake.
It's a drake, yes, but still, it's...
We don't have no dragons, no.
That drake kicked my ass about 7 or 8 times last night. Because what it does is it jumps up, it stomps, it'll then cling to the walls, start showering you in fire, or start flying in the middle of the air and just shoot a cone of flames, which is nearly insta-kill, unless you dodge right away.
Oh, that sounds like fun!
Yeah,
that's why I'm in Skyrim.
And the thing is, once you kill that, you fight three more.
In the next area as regular enemies.
I'm going back to Skyrim, guys. Thank you very much. I'll be seeing you sometime soon.
At least those that do the Cone of Flame.
Right. So, Leo, how's your week?
My week was pretty good. Did quite a bit of traveling, took a couple of road trips during my spring break. Did a lot of... saw a couple of different animes. You introduced me to Bakano. Over one of the trips.
Alright.
It's really nice. Unfortunately, no streaming service actually has it.
Oh, man.
Which
dude.
Means I have to go ahead and fork out some cash for a DVD set if I want to see the rest of the series.
You're not going to go and look at, like...
Crunchyroll doesn't have it. Hulu doesn't have it.
You do know that I go to this one place, Kiss Anime.
Yeah, I don't trust those websites because I have a history of bugs with those websites.
And
this
are
one.
They sub-only, or do they have the dubs?
So far, I don't know. They do have both subs and dubs.
And even the...
I'm watching Assassination Classroom on that one. They're pumping out both the sub and the dub at the same time.
But again, This is an obscure anime which is based off a light novel that was released in 2007.
Ah. Bakano is, what?
Oh, yeah, you know what? I just realized there was something else that I also did over the weekend.
What?
I watched an anime as well. Scrapped Princess.
What does that sound familiar?
I don't know that one.
I think I may have mentioned it back in high school because...
No, but I've seen it, like, in the various halls of DVDs and books, and I'm trying to remember what the premise of it is.
Premise is... This one princess was set. There was a prophecy that this princess would be the poison to end the world.
Of course.
When she turned 16.
Any particular reason why?
I'll just say it involves lost cybernetic history, because the entire world is in like this fantasy medieval setting.
It's a fantasy medieval setting, but the old world has a lot of super sci-fi tech.
Yes.
Okay.
At least
like one of the super sci-fi techs is like. The princess's brother, adopted brother, uses a power called a dragon, And it's basically a giant cybernetic dragon. Which is pretty damn awesome. It's a pretty damn awesome show. And what hit me hard was the fact that, like, at least 5 or 6 of the characters in that, in the dub, also voice characters from Xenosaga. Like Xion,
Oh, that's why. Remember that time we were watching Xenosaga 1 or 2?
Yeah.
I was going through to see who everyone's voice actor was. I think that's where it came, I think the name popped up a couple of times.
Yeah. Pacifica Castool, the Scrap Princess's brother.
The VA is who?
Well, not her, but her adopted brother, Shannon. He is voiced by Crispin Freeman, who voices a lot of popular characters, including Albedo. All
right. Now, speaking of craziness, Bacchano, which is Italian for chaos.
The closer translation is a lot of noise.
Yes, but I prefer chaos because that's probably the best part of this. The setting is bounces around between the 1930s and different years, going on between 3 different stories and a kaleidoscope of wonderful, colorful characters.
Mm-hmm.
Prohibition-era U.S.
Yes, which means gangsters.
Nice.
Some of which are immortal.
Really?
Yes. You cut off his head, it reattaches itself, all the blood shoots right back into his body.
That's a little kooky.
I remember the premise was Cowboy Bebop, as done with the backdrop of Big O, replacing steampunk with alchemy.
Yes.
So I'm picturing Cowboy Bebop, Big O, and Full Metal Alchemist all fused into one, and I am suddenly getting very intrigued.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
It's very interesting.
Absolutely.
Although, keep in mind, I was never a fan of Bebop when I was growing up.
Well,
and yet I was a fan of Big O.
And that's another 50 subscribers going ahead and raging at you for saying that you've never watched Cowboy Bebop.
Let me clarify. I saw it on Toonami. I saw it on Adult Swim. But I never fully got invested into the series.
I suppose. There was one point where I said, I have to stop watching this.
Keep in mind, I also liked Inuyasha as a kid, so my tastes were kind of stupid.
Dude, there is nothing wrong with Inuyasha.
Kagome is a real sociopath.
It's a piece of anime and manga history.
It is, and the problem is it's a shitty part of the history.
Just because...
What do you mean it's a shitty part of the history? Explain yourself, sir.
Because you're losing subscribers left and right.
Well, I doubt we'll lose subscribers over this.
Watch them.
But I believe I was trying to talk about my week before I got interrupted twice.
Alright,
go for it.
Thank you. I've been doing, since I can't play video games, what I have been doing is a lot of build making. For
yes.
Both Dark Souls 1 and Dark Souls 2.
As well as GURPS, if I'm not mistaken.
And GURPS a little bit less so, but that one was pretty much up and done this morning.
Alright.
I've been, again, when it comes to things I obsess about, I don't get much sleep. Lots of trafficking, lots of stuff for school, and that's pretty much it. Just counting down the weeks until Easter shows up.
Alright then, so I guess with that out of the way, I guess we should move into the news section, huh?
Alright.
Okay.
So, let's start off with the douchebag of the week.
First up, we have Springfield, Illinois gives key to the city to... Wait, this has to be a typo, correct?
No, it's not.
Cobra Commander? What?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, this happened. It's legit.
let me rephrase myself. What?
Yeah, this is a real thing that happened. Now, to be fair, the legitimate reason for this is because the Springfield actually did a lot of hosting for the shooting of the modern G.I. Joe movies. So they've rewarded the city to the actors into the company who were graciously donating their efforts and energy and money into the city.
Ah.
Why the fuck they chose Cobra Commander to give it to, I have no idea.
Instead of, like, I don't know, one of the lead members of...
Well, the Duke, obviously.
Well,
I can imagine for the exact reason that we're talking about it, for the publicity.
Probably. You know what? This does sound like a publicity stunt, so let's move on from this stupidity and go on to the next thing on their list.
Roundabouts.
A limo driving game is reclassified post-release.
It's considered more offensive and more gory than Dark Souls 2. When did we consider Dark Souls 2 gory? I mean, it's not like you're lopping off heads.
Now, that's why I'd be in Bloodborne, with all the blood splatter everywhere.
Now, that's different. But Dark Souls 2...
I really did not find that much gore in Dark Souls 2.
Well, that's
the
because
thing
it's
that
T-rated.
I know. The thing that kind of put me off about Dark Souls 2 was that one monster in Dranglaic Castle that was basically a Silent Hill monster. It was basically chained to the wall upside down, and its face was a keyhole. And it was moaning.
Oh, man.
And you had to go into this area, the annoying area I was mentioning before.
Oh, yeah, I completely forgot to ask you about this fact, but since we're live, I might as well ask you. What did you think of the creature that you saved in that area?
The creature that I saved?
After you used the key to open up the Silent Hill enemy's face?
Well, she's certainly interesting.
Well, do you know... Why don't you say the name of the creature that you saved?
Ornifex?
No.
Oh, no.
I don't really know what they're called.
Milfinito.
Milfinito.
Wait. This isn't a fan name.
No, this is... They literally... This is canon. They say it themselves. They're called Milfinito.
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 They're basically just women who know nothing of the out... They are literally waifus.
No, they're not. They don't have genders.
They look like women.
They look like women, but they don't have anything.
They know nothing of the outside world.
Yes.
And all they do is sing.
To go ahead and contain the demon that's underneath the castle, yes.
Remind me, what's the demon underneath the castle?
Demon of Song.
Oh, which I killed, which was a really easy boss. It really was. All you have to do is just stay, like, barely out of its reach of its...
I'm surprised.
T-Rex arms.
I'm surprised, but I digress.
Big head and tiny little arms. This plan wasn't thought out.
But I digress.
It actually wasn't that hard. The only thing that kind of catches you off guard is when it does the body slam. You gotta move fast out of the way.
Alright.
But yeah, Dark Souls 2, not gory. So, where were we?
But no, that's the thing, is that this game is considered more hardcore than that.
Oh, it's considered more hardcore. That's different.
That's what it is. It's more violent than Dark Souls 2.
Well, we don't play Dark Souls 2 for violence. We play Dark Souls 2 to get violent in anger.
So that's the thing. This game, which is basically kind of like... it's the next level of Crazy Taxi. Got reclassified post-release from T to M.
Huh.
Hmm.
Okay.
And you think that's okay? That the ESRB can just do that?
Well, I really don't know what... I would have to see the game for myself.
So you didn't read the article?
Well, for me...
I read the article, I just didn't see the video.
Okay, for a while now, the ESRB has been kind of bullshit
stupid.
To me.
Stupid?
I mean, they latch onto, like, one or two things.
And then decide
that... And then
that
ignore
that...
the rest.
Yeah.
As a whole.
Like, I go back to how they had, like, Dark Cloud as a teen game. I really did not think that was a teen game.
I could see it sort of as a teen game. Honestly.
Sort of, but the only thing I remember, like, let me go ahead and check with the rating.
Monica's Bikini.
Monica's Bikini? That's for Dark Cloud 2.
Oh, Dark Cloud 1 you're talking about?
Yes. There was, like, barely any blood in there, and that was more like enemy blood, which was, like, green.
Ruby.
Which is considered fantasy blood.
Ruby.
Yeah.
Because she was the femme fatale of that game, so, Ruby.
Yeah... The boss's wife.
I don't know. I mean, Smash Brothers is actually considered rated T for teen.
Really?
Yeah. And it still is.
Well,
for cartoon violence.
Yeah.
You know what? The ESRB really kind of has some bullshit.
Like I said!
Yeah.
It's always been bullshit.
Go.
Okay, so what else do we have on the list?
And now... The most important thing that is rattling the internet since the invention of the Game Boy.
Nintendo finally going into the mobile markets!
Okay, I was looking into this, and I gotta say it's not a bad step for Nintendo. I will say, because I know that they have, they're planning on doing both mobile, tablet, PC ports, which, actually, if they decide to do PC ports of some older Nintendo games, I would not mind that.
But I would like to, I just want to throw this out here. I really hope that they get the control scheme right, because remember a little while back that I tried to play Monster Hunter?
And you had to go ahead and fork out, what was it?
$20.
But
I was able to get it for $20. I got the actual solid controller.
But you were initially looking at spending how much for a decent MiFi controller?
The MiFi controller was originally sold for $80+.
Which is bullshit.
Yes, so I got the markdown version for $20. But here's where I lost it. I went ahead and tried syncing it to the device, which it actually did. And I found out that Monster Hunter Freedom Unite is one of the games that post 8.0 updates for the iPads and any iOS software in general. These games lost contact with all MiFi controllers.
Really?
Yes. I shelled out $20 for nothing.
For a piece of plastic.
At least it was an 80.
At least it wasn't 80, but it's still bullshit.
If it was 80, I would be pretty sure I could hear you screaming from all the way from here.
No, I'm pretty sure we could hear you screaming all the way from the other side of town.
I'm pretty sure you could hear me screaming from the other side of the continent.
That being said, this is a terrible move.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, because part of the reading between the lines, they're not making older games. Everything that they're putting out on the mobile market will be quote-unquote new. Which means, to a lot of fans dismay, we're not going to get ROMs of the classic Pokemon games, we're not going to get ROMs of the older Mario games, and we're not going to get ROMs of things like Donkey Kong or any of their handheld systems going to the mobile market.
However, they also are working on a new console, Project NX.
Which is, in all fairness, it's a non-announcement.
True.
Because of how stupidly they decided to toss it in there. What that was damage control.
Damage control to prevent...
That was the fire suppressant that they tossed in so that the fanboys would say, at least they're still making handhelds.
Handhelds
but
or consoles.
But if they had gone back and released the classic Super Mario trilogy, if they had gone back, put out at least Red and Blue, I would have preferred Yellow personally, but Red and Blue... If they had done, let's say, Metroid Zero Mission,
right.
I think they would have immediate entry into the market rather than trying to make new Gonzo bullshit.
And also, I'm wondering why Nintendo never did that for the virtual console on, like, the 3DS. Why they never bothered to dish them out. All I keep seeing is older, obscure crap that I've never even heard of.
To be fair, the older, obscure crap that we've never heard of probably sells more. That's why they put it on there. Because I certainly know that, yeah, there's a lot of popular games that they could have put out there, but who would actually buy that is kind of sketchy when the dedicated cult-following malarkey will almost always have a market. That is part of the reason why Dead or Alive 5 will continue to have the bouncy titties. Despite the fact that everyone in the fighting game community calls it a distraction.
Ah, Team Ninja. You perverts.
Well, people are buying their games. So something they're doing is working.
Keep in mind, I am...
right, exactly.
Like I've said, wallet talks.
And that's all it is. I mean, we can go ahead and debate the actual semantics of it, but so long as it sells... That's all that matters.
Yeah, this seems like a way to keep Nintendo afloat, kind of.
But then again,
Nintendo has enough money that if they defaulted every year, I'm pretty sure that they could survive for another 50 years.
Yeah, but that's not something that the shareholders want to hear.
I know.
So, again, it's a matter of the money. Which, again, brings us back to Nintendo NX, the next handheld platform.
Is it handheld or is it a console?
I think they said it was handheld because that was part of the reason why they mentioned it, Legend. Do you recall if that's the case?
I'm not sure. But what I did catch is...
Because if it's a new handheld, I'm going to be a little bit furious considering I just shelled out $200 for a new Nintendo 3DS.
Well, here's the thing. Again, it's a non-issue because they just announced that we're working on a new console. There is no indication that it's coming out next year or the next 3 years.
That is true, because still, the Nintendo 3DS is still pretty good in its lifespan. It's got at least another 3 years on it.
That being said, Nintendo always has a notorious issue about entering the next generation very early.
Yeah.
So don't count your chickens before they hatch.
That's true.
Here's the infuriating thing, though.
Yeah, the pre-orders.
They all... Wait, no.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sellers are already offering pre-orders for the Nintendo NX.
There's no price on it yet, but they will take your money anyway.
Talk about early access bullshit.
It's money.
I think we should just splatter that GIF right on the podcast right now.
Okay. Now, technically, this... ends douchebag of the week, but this next article, I wanted to count for douchebag of the week just because of how terrible it is.
And that
fire away.
Pixels, the video game movie, made its first mistake by starring Adam Sandler.
Okay. Okay. I'm gonna go on a little rant about Adam Sandler for a moment, so bear with me.
You got 3 minutes.
Adam Sandler is not funny. He is one of the sole reasons for the death of comedy, if you ask me. I have seen... You know how in movie theaters, you know how they try to show like clips for the next movie?
Yeah,
like for comedies? What they show you in those clips are supposed to be the funny parts to get you to go see the full movie. I have not laughed once at an Adam Sandler movie. Not once. Last movie I saw was Click, and that was more sickeningly depressing than funny.
Well, prepare to go ahead and have whatever remains of childhood crushed as this movie comes out, because it is by far the most tragic thing I've ever seen related to nerddom. So here's the premise.
Adam Sandler's a cancer on comedy.
Here's the premise. The premise is that as part of the space age exploration effort, a cartridge was released into space featuring some of the classic video games, Pac-Man, Donkey Kong, Space Invaders, and it was released to go ahead and for whatever organization or civilization to discover.
Oh no.
Something happened between then and now, and we are being attacked by, you guessed it, Pac-Man, Donkey Kong, Alien Invaders.
You want to borrow my screen pillow?
No, thanks. I think I'll keep this one on the inside.
Oh, there's...
I'm not!
I was going to say that screen pillow might be a bit premature because I'm not finished yet.
Oh, here we go.
The United States military, because the United States military, of course, is going to be the one to interfere in this border bullshit.
Of course.
Assembles the team, grabs Adam Sandler and tells him to assemble a team of people to go ahead and fight video games the only way they know how. By beating them at their own game. So you see screenshots of them climbing... Literally climbing up the 100 meters for Donkey Kong, shooting back with giant laser turrets at Space Invaders, and as the central focal point of the trailer, getting into four BMW Mini Coopers as ghosts to go hunt down Pac-Man.
Okay,
that's
it. To be fair, the movie sounds awesome. The only problem is their choice in casting.
You know what?
Do you remember the the actor who did Paul Blart Mall Cop?
Kevin Smith.
He also has a starring role in this.
Hmm.
If that sours your mood anymore.
It kind of does, because he's not funny.
Okay. Now.
I've seen him in King of Queens, and
here's arguably the most cringeworthy moment of the trailer is near the end, in which they actually get the actual creator of Pac-Man as not only to star in the appear in the movie, but to actually appear as a supervisor to the American Defense Force to fight off the video game threat. At one point, he interferes with a Pac-Man hunt, trying to go ahead and quote-unquote talk to his son. And then he goes ahead and tries to pet Pac-Man in the timid man-meets-monster moment, only for about half of his forearm to get bitten by Pac-Man and digitalized into pixels. Upon which he swears at the main cast and tells him to go ahead and kill the bastard. Paraphrasing, by the way.
I'm done! Well, it's official! We've now witnessed the fall of Western civilization. Gentlemen, what are your plans for the apocalypse?
Making sure everything that I own is unplugged and not in use. Also, getting rid of my Facebook account. Because that is the second way you will die.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on from the apocalypse.
No, we're moving on from one apocalypse to horror.
Hmm?
In addition to Pixels, this next little trailer came out. Unfriended, the horror movie.
Oh, I saw that!
What?
Okay.
You haven't seen this ad on YouTube about a horror movie where it was talking about this girl who was, they had a video of her, passed out drunk at a party.
Is this a skippable one?
Yes.
Okay, then there's a reason why I have not seen it.
Well, basically, it's this girl gets bullied because of a video posted of her getting drunk at a party. She commits suicide, and then all her friends are in the Skype chat, and she's in there as well. And they start dying one by one by one by one in the classic
horror movie style.
Yeah, and it's called Unfriended, and it shows, like, trippy scenes of, like, this one guy just screaming like this, and all the pixels just kind of warp around him. That scene actually did look kind of creepy, just because of the warped pixels, but that's it.
But the part where a dude gets his hand forcibly fed to a blender did nothing to you?
I didn't even see that one.
Yeah, that was a thing.
Huh. I did not see that. It was going by so fast, I couldn't tell.
Well, then. But yeah, this is a thing.
Okay.
It was initially released, apparently, back in 2013 at a film festival, but now it's getting a major motion release.
And it's called Unfriended, which immediately made me think the social media culture, and it made me want to kick something small, cute, and cuddly.
To be fair, I kind of approve of this.
You do?
Yeah.
Yeah, you?
Yeah, because we need teenagers to not act like complete idiots on the internet. Scaring them straight. Scaring them straight with this is totally fine with me.
Oh, if it does work, I laugh even harder.
Also, funnily enough,
if Facebook suddenly collapses into a downward spiral, I will watch this movie just to see if it actually happened.
That being said, one of the more interesting things is on the R-rated title where it describes why it's being rated R-rated. It actually makes a very good point to highlight this is all happening to teenagers. So, just an awkward thing that I thought I'd point out that I thought was interesting.
Yeah. Although I do agree, I kind of am surprised it's actually focusing on something about social media that I think doesn't really get highlighted that much.
Yeah.
The cyberbullying and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's... I mean, bullying can happen regardless of medium, whether it's face-to-face or
online.
Even worse, anonymous.
Yeah. The second... You give anyone anonymity... And an audience. That's how trolls are made, gentlemen.
Trolls, assholes.
Yeah, basic douchebags. Like Justin Bieber.
Oh,
joy.
So this is happening in a week, guys. Record your set your DVRs.
What?
Comedy Central presents The Roast of Justin Bieber.
Why would I watch that?
To watch everyone put the screws into everyone's most hated Canadian.
Besides Mariah Carey?
Mariah Carey's Canadian?
Yeah.
Seriously?
I think so.
I did not know this. Okay, so you're telling me you actually hate Mariah Carey more than Justin Bieber? Is that what you're telling me?
I hate her singing.
But you hate her more than Justin Bieber?
No.
That's what I'm saying. So everyone's most hated Canadian is Justin Bieber.
Well, I forget if it was Mariah Carey or someone else, but I think it's Mariah Carey.
I'd be very impressed if that was Mariah Carey. She would be the hottest Canadian I know then.
Anyway.
But yeah, so.
But why did I submit myself to an hour and a half of seeing Justin Bieber's ugly smug mug?
Well, actually, you'd be seeing such famous faces as Kevin Hart going ahead and ripping Justin Bieber a new one. He would just be sitting in a giant chair forcing to take it.
Well, wait, if Kevin Hart's coming up to the podium, don't they need, like, a footstool for him?
He's not that short.
Oh, boy.
Well, he's the roast master, after all, so.
So they will need a stool.
Okay, well, in other news, finally some humanitarian stuff.
Let's talk about something nice for once.
Yes, thank God for humanitarian horror game producers. What?
Yeah, actually, also, the creator of Five Nights at Freddy's.
Scott Cawthorn.
Yeah. He and St. Jude's Children's Hospital was having a fundraiser.
They were doing a live stream for donations.
And their goal was $15K. Scott went and dished out $250,000.
No, just under $250,000.
Just under
$250,000 to St. Jude's.
The exact amount was $249,999.
Really?
I bet you that's the maximum amount you can spend before you have to pay taxes. I guarantee it.
You know that's probably true.
Probably true, but
so
awesome nevertheless. The fact that he did this,
yeah.
I think it highlights a lot of, I think, what he was trying to do with Five Nights at Freddy's.
Yeah.
Now that I think about it.
Well, actually, the reason why he made Five Nights at Freddy's is because one of his older games, which, surprisingly, the guy was also known for making a lot of Christian games, a lot of Bible games.
Right.
And he says he made them because God told him to do it.
So we have God to thank for our pants being stained yellow?
Actually, yeah. Part of the reason that Cawthorn transferred over from Christian games to Five Nights at Freddy's was one of his later projects featured unusual-looking animatronics, and I think someone commented to him that those look like they belong in a horror game when they were reviewing it negatively.
Yeah, well, no,
so
it was
so he went ahead and did.
It was these beavers that looked like they were animatronic, like creepy animatronics.
But again, they were being... They were being criticized for looking like they belong in a horror game. To which Cawthorn responded, "Challenge accepted, motherfuckers." and thus one of the most influential horror games since Slender was born.
Yeah, another renaissance of horror games started after that.
Yep, mm-hmm. And with Five Nights 2 and 3, I felt like, just looking at like the behind the scenes stuff, the little Easter eggs, I felt like he really did want us to become attached to these kids who ended up just becoming ghosts and being trapped in these rather silly looking animatronics.
Which on my art site have been extremely fetishized.
Oh boy.
But especially Foxy.
The fact that he did this
Foxy
for
first,
kids.
Then Chica.
Yep.
Then Muggins.
Like to give justice to kids and to give kids a fighting chance. The fact that he did this, it really does strike a chord.
Oh yeah, there is. I have nothing bad to say about this. This is just pure, honest to goodness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Which we need a lot more of in the world.
And we did lose a little bit of it. One of my favorite authors, Sir Terry Pratchett. The author of the Discworld series and sundry others. Lots and lots of different books.
You know what? I'm sad to say this, but I've never read any of his books.
Well, I do highly recommend it. He was really, really dry-witted, but he really hit a lot of humanitarian chords with his stuff. I mean, I was laughing the whole way through, but it always struck a chord, especially with one where... I kid you not, one of his books has the Grim Reaper basically take on the role of Santa Claus. It is glorious.
Okay. I would like to read that.
There is also one where the Grim Reaper picks up the guitar.
Okay, so literally death rock.
Yes! He's got a lot of this stuff. He's got ones about witches. Witches are actually very, very clever in these series. Lots of different stuff, but... Unfortunately, I really... Oh, man. We're not going to be seeing more of that.
Mm.
But for Sir Terry Pratchett, yeah, he's still going to be one of my absolute favorite authors from here on in and out. All right, so...
Well, from sad news to slightly more depressing news.
Joy!
Kojima's leaving Konami.
Oh my goodness, back!
Wow! And Kojima is basically one of the few things keeping Konami afloat.
Oh,
the other thing being Yu-Gi-Oh! Yeah, because God knows Castlevania isn't doing shit right now.
Neither is Silent Hill.
Well, I mean, there was just a thing. But yeah, it's pretty much Yu-Gi-Oh! Now that's keeping it in the black.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
But yeah, so the deal was that...
And I don't even think Yu-Gi-Oh! Will be keeping it in the black for much longer.
I think it's going to be around, but the story went that initially there were concerns over changes in the cover art for Metal Gear Solid 5 and for the new collection that was going to be released with it. That featured 4, 5, and Phantom and Ground Zeroes, the prequel to 5.
So it would have both 4 and?
It would have 4, Phantom Pain, and Ground Zeroes.
Huh.
But the deal was that, because it's titled Hideo, a game made by Hideo Kojima, or Hideo Kojima's Metal Gear Solid. That was being removed in these new cover arts that were being revealed. So people started poking around and asking questions of what was going on with Kojima. And as it turns out, Kojima is leaving at the end of the year.
Oh, man.
And so the section of Konami that he was working at changed their name. His name is being removed from Konami's Metal Gear Solid arts. And he's going to go ahead, I'm assuming, leave and go start up his own project.
Well... By the way, is he still going to be working on the whole Silent Hills game?
Yeah, he's still stated to be working with Silent Hills, but although I don't know if this means that he's going to be doing it in a different way.
Wait, and I'm still wondering if Konami's going to be part of that.
I would assume so, but I think what's going to end up happening is that they're going to be working with Kojima, but he's going to be like sort of like how Inafune broke off and started his own development company. I think Kojima might be doing the same way.
Wow, that's going to be an awkward development cycle.
Well, that's not the only thing. The other thing that kind of just rung with a lot of people was that there was a discussion regarding Metal Gear Solid 5, and one of the comments that Kojima made was that, you know, regardless of what happens, I feel that Metal Gear Solid ends at 5. So I think that Konami might have been pushing for
more,
and Kojima didn't want his name to be a part of it. So this exact situation, in fact, happened with Inafune, where he was going to end the Mega Man X series at the 5th game, but Capcom made a 6th installment without his permission, without his involvement, not his permission, but his involvement.
And then they made 7, which was
well at 7 and 8, but eventually at that point he had moved from the series and he was doing Zero, the Mega Man Zero series for the GBA, but I think that kind of schism might have happened, and that why might be a reason why you might be seeing this out of Kojima.
So we might be seeing something similar happen with those high end games, Metal Gear, the.
So it's a very interesting future to see what's going to happen with Konami now.
Yeah, and from what I'm guessing, if things don't start improving for Konami, like, I doubt Yu-Gi-Oh! Could keep them afloat entirely.
I disagree with you, but again, time will tell.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm giving a hypothetical here. If Yu-Gi-Oh! Can't keep it afloat, they might have to start selling off some of their IPs.
Well, as it is, they don't have that, they're not that powerful as a, their stock is like $12.
Wow.
I mean, that's per certificate, but still, I mean, you could easily go out and buy a stock certificate in Konami.
Though I'm not sure I want to.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah, and that's part of the reason.
Yeah,
so,
I don't
so
see...
After something like this, it's going to drop even more than it already has.
Yes.
So I think that's going to be a very big concern
for
the shareholders.
It's probably
going
to go from like 12 to 6.
Well, I wouldn't say that, but it doesn't look very good for Konami. And I hope Kojima does well in the future.
I got to admit, despite Kojima being a little... coked up.
Kojima. Oh no, 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 no. I have to show you Itagaki. That dude.
Well, you've seen Suda 51. You know what? You know how crazy it can get.
I know. I know. I'm just talking about how rambling Kojima can be.
Yeah, but
he still makes some damn good games.
Kojima is sane compared to Suda 51. Good lord, that's true.
Exactly, and that's not even talking about like Itagaki, who is the dude behind, who is the dude that works with Team Ninja. So you know you have to be crazy in a game in which you're pushing a small, flat-chested French girl and saying she's 18.
What?
And putting her on the cover of the latest DO5 edition.
You know what?
I thought I was the crazy one here.
You know what? I want to create the ultimate game of insanity. I want to get these three madmen together. I want them.
51, Itagaki, and Kojima.
Yes.
I will go ahead and say that there probably is a game that already simulates this very well, and that is Rumble Roses.
Really?
Dress physics, insane plot story, and it actually is considered canonical in the Metal Gear Solid universe. I shit you not.
What?
I heard somewhere that apparently there is a connection between the Rumble Roses universe and Metal Gear Solid via the Vita games.
What?
I don't know how, but apparently that's a thing.
Okay, I'm gonna have to look this shit up.
Alright.
Oh my god.
Speaking of shit you're gonna look up, Project Ukulele revealed at South by Southwest Gaming.
Woohoo! Yeah, I saw this whole thing.
Yeah.
Alright.
So, no longer speculation, it exists.
Uh-huh.
Alright.
All the old people from Rare got together and are starting to put this game into action. And in fact, they have multiple games planned out. Like, characters from the first game will have their own game. But it won't be a platformer, it would be a different style of game altogether. And friends from one game will be enemies in the other one, or vice versa.
Oh, that could be interesting.
So we're making the Rare cinematic universe.
They said they were inspired by Marvel's universe. They were inspired by the Marvel universe.
Yeah, the Rare cinematic universe, that's going to be a term now.
Oh my gosh. If they can pull it off. If they can manage to pull it off.
Their Kickstarter starts in May, if I'm not mistaken.
I can't throw my money at it yet.
Back that shit indeed.
You know what? I actually might actually register on Kickstarter and actually donate some money for this.
Legend's gonna make it rain. Just toss all the singles at Banjo-Kazooie. I'm pretty sure there's fan art of that somewhere.
Of Legend throwing money at... Why?
No, I'm pretty sure there's like some sort of Rule 63 of Banjo on a stripper pole or something.
Oh, God.
I have seen Banjo with boobs. Boob Joes.
I washed my hands of this.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Well, don't wash your hands yet. We're off to the Indie Horror Corner.
Oh, joy!
PAX East Edition!
Actually, we're going to be doing that. I need to wash my hands first. Anyway, moving on!
No, you're going to need to take a couple of drug tests. That's what that is. But anyway, we have a... I decided to go through the... What showed up at PAX, and I chose four games I think are going to be the most interesting to watch.
Okay. Which would be, starting with...
The Vagrant.
The Vagrant.
Oh, God. I'm just looking at this description. Oh, no.
It looks gorgeous. The combat is fluid, and it's very awesome. It's very comfortable to look at.
Oh, joy!
So, explain to our audience.
So, the trailer goes ahead and features the Vagrant, a woman sword fighter who uses a belt for a bra, journeying across a dragon's crown-like world. Yeah, pretty much like that, and then she has a short red overcoat.
Pretty much like that, using a visual gag for an audio recording.
God damn it, guys! But anyway,
we talked about this!
But yeah, Dragon's Crown meets Muramasa the Demon Blade with a nice slice of carrot cheesecake.
Carrot cheesecake? Care to explain why it's carrot cheesecake?
Okay, apparently neither of you watched the intro video, because you would have noticed the very buxom garden girl who was picking up a little carrot.
Double face palm.
But it
sounds fun.
Your lack of interest fails to amuse me. By the way, I haven't mentioned the part where there's a small girl wearing a bear hat that transforms into a full-grown buxom werebear.
Say what?
Yeah, that's a character.
So we're talking about that kind of game.
Well, it's a crazy kind of game. Again, and on the Dragon's Crown part, it very much has the same sexual style.
However,
like super brute buff men and super sexualized women.
Yeah, for some parts of it anyway.
Oh, Tumblr's going to have a field day with this game.
Yeah.
Sir Keaton's going to have a field day with this
game. Well, it also has a very stylish combat, and again, it stars a somewhat sexually attractive but badass-kicking female protagonist.
I might look up this a bit more. It's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And what's it coming out for?
I think it's a downloadable for the consoles, but I don't remember exactly where it's coming out. I think it's just for the consoles, though.
All right.
Next up, Enter the Gungeon.
Oh, joy.
So
FPS meets dungeon crawling?
Kind of, except it's from a top-down perspective.
I kind of hate those games. Top-downs.
So it's D&D meets Bullet Hell.
Oh God, no!
Yes.
So imagine running around Gotham style, but with guns. And the enemies are also firing bullets at you.
Why am I picturing a Toho game set in a dungeon?
Yeah, it's actually kind of accurate, actually, except with less fetish.
It's actually kind of sounds similar to something that my boyfriend was trying to make.
Really?
Yeah, he's trying to make like an RPG.
Mm-hmm.
I told him to start doing like a Toho game first because he was really into those.
Uh-huh.
Alright.
Yeah, those are actually very useful to go ahead and get used to engines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially Unity for him.
Mm-hmm. Alright, next on the list, Dad by the Sword.
Skyrim meets Adventure Time. What?
So, this is a first-person hack and slash that the sword... For, I'm not shitting you, feels flaccid.
What?
So, this is the one I know of kind of the least about, but the idea is basically you're journeying around through this, again, it looks like a drip out of Adventure Time, and you're basically journeying around and, I mean, the thing about it that's so interesting, aside from the terrible, terrible dad pun used in the title, is the fact that the combat is actually described as kind of flaccid, for lack of a better term.
Oh man!
But apparently there's it makes itself work with in a sort of Dark Souls-y sort of way, easy respawns, learnable patterns, etc.
Okay.
Huh.
And then the last one that I have...
I'm speechless for that one.
The last one that I have here is the most awkward of the four, and that's Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes.
The worst, best thriller game ever.
Okay, so what this is a quote-unquote co-op virtual reality game with the, I'm assuming, something like Oculus.
Okay.
And one person goes ahead and puts on the Oculus headset... and is sent in, and it has a bomb right in front of him. The other player is supposed to actually look through a packaged manual, which comes with the game, and instruct the other player on how to disarm the bomb.
You sound British there for a second.
Oh my gosh, this sounds amazing.
So, you literally have to walk through disarming a bomb.
Wow.
This actually sounds awesome.
Cut the red wire. No, the blue wire. Wait, the blue wire. Set the blue wire.
So this is for all those people who ever wanted to feel like an action hero in an action B-movie with the pliers and the bomb.
With the pliers and the bomb and your friends co-starring as the stupid guy who won't tell you the right direction.
It's brilliant.
So this is either the worst thriller game ever
or the
best thriller game ever.
This is awesome.
I don't know how to process this. My brain is starts. Do I suddenly smell blue?
So yeah, this is a small snippet of what was issued at PAX. The next big thing coming up is the E3, gentlemen, so be ready for it.
Yeah, and like we said before, Bethesda's going to be jumping in on this one.
Oh,
first
God.
Time ever.
I would kill to be able to go to E3 this year.
Well, speaking of Bethesda, They're currently busy at work trying to make up one of their blunders.
Ah, yes.
So,
ESO.
So that's actually no longer going to exist anymore.
ESO?
It's actually getting rebranded as Tamriel Unlimited.
Oh.
So I'm assuming that they're making a bunch of upgrades to go ahead and change the name and consequently change the terrible publicity it had on opening.
Kind of like Final Fantasy XIV A Realm Reborn.
Yeah, kind of like that.
Well, it's basically standard MMO strategy. MMO developer strategy. If it doesn't work the first time,
you
reincarnate it.
So they're going on New Game Plus for this one. Hopefully balance out some of the issues, make the story more exciting, because I know that was terrible.
Yeah.
So
combat was awkward, story was terrible.
So hopefully they
was
can go
terrible.
Ahead, they can go ahead and try that the second time around.
Mm.
Alright. Though my money would probably be going towards getting a PS4 and looking into Dragon's Dogma Online. Because that, if they are really going to go all in with this, that looks like fun.
Hmm.
And they're actually getting the pawns to shut the hell up this time.
Joy! So can you actually tell them to shut up, or can you,
No. You can choose to not have pawns. The pawns are only there to fill in the gaps if you can't find human players to play alongside you.
Ah.
And all four of you, in a party of four, can be anything. You can be a healer, a mage, you know, the standard stuff. But the combat is the same from Dragon's Dogma, the original one. And it is just as fast and fluid, just from what I saw from the trailer.
Damn.
That said, this is Capcom, this is Dragon's Dogma. We have yet to see what the full specs of this game are going to be. But if it is as good as they're saying it is, it might become a classic.
Hmm.
That's my prediction.
Well, I don't have too high hopes for Tamriel Unlimited. But you never know. I mean, Final Fantasy A Realm Reborn got pretty popular pretty quick.
Alright.
So, who knows?
Who knows? Who knows?
Well, maybe not as good. This next game won't be as big, but it certainly is going to be interesting. Tembo, the badass elephant game being made for Sega.
By Game Freak. For every platform. Not just Nintendo.
What?
So, this game, it seems to be a return to classic platforming.
Hmm.
You are an elephant commando.
You're basically Elephant Rambo.
What?
Yeah.
You are Tembo.
Oh my gosh.
And you're charging through levels, jumping, charging, saving people.
As an elephant commando.
Let me guess, he gets health ups from peanuts.
Yeah, that's the
collectible peanuts. Now,
oh,
and I believe
man.
After he fills up his peanut butter jar, he gets an extra life.
Yeah,
his
peanut butter jar.
This
is the sort of cheesy nonsense that I missed from video games, that they actually had a sense of humor.
Yeah, you know, I do miss the good old quirky games of old.
Though we are still seeing them in the 80s.
Aye, but this one's actually being made by someone who actually has some clout.
Yeah.
So
Game Freak.
So if you thought Game Freak was just good at Pokemon, fuck you!
What was the name of that rhythm game that they also made?
Harmonite.
Harmonite, yeah. I still haven't played that.
Yeah, that was also made by Game Freak.
Hmm, interesting.
Alright, this is a more interesting one. I know Zero, you probably won't care. Legend, I think you might get a kick out of this. Rock Band 4 is going to make a return.
Oh, joy! So we'll finally have a reason to go back to the store and pick up those old guitars?
Yeah, that's going to be the hope.
That's the hope, but will it sell?
Well, the idea is going to be that it's just going to be one.
Only one guitar?
No, one game. One game, and then just updates.
That's probably true.
So DLCs and patches, and that's how you get more songs. You won't have to buy a new disc in the store every year or so.
Interesting.
You know, that's probably what they should have done from the beginning.
Yeah, but to be fair, Activision didn't make it easy for them by trying to compete with Guitar Hero.
True.
And that's kind of the concern since both of them are trying to come back.
Oh, God, Activision.
That being said, one of the things they are saying that they're doing is if you have a PS3 account with Rock Band on it, and all you have to, you can actually upgrade your account when Rock Band 4 comes out.
That's actually pretty nice.
So if you have PS3 or Xbox 360, and you go up to PS4 and Xbox One, which, again, I hate that name.
Yeah. I still call it the Xbox.
You can transfer your stuff up.
Hmm.
Which is a very nice feature.
All right. So they are taking into account the old games.
Right.
I remember we played, was it Rock Band?
Yeah, it was Rock Band for one of my birthdays.
Yeah, I actually didn't kind of, I did enjoy that.
Right.
Remind me, what the hell did we play?
A lot of songs on that one. But again, that's kind of the appeal, and that's what they want to bring back.
All right, and I can respect that.
I actually wouldn't mind doing that for just like when we hang out and get together.
Yeah.
Now,
although the problem is finding a place to store those big plastic pieces of.
Well, that much isn't going to get fixed, so you're going to have to stick with that.
Yeah.
Now, please tell me you at least saw this one. Final Fantasy 15 episode Duske. Which is their demo.
Their demo. I did not get a chance to fully see that. I saw at least half of it, damn it.
Unfortunately, I had some difficulties myself.
So, episode Duske is basically a side story that is supposedly one featured, which doesn't have any plot relevance, but does the job of introducing the players to the characters and to the game.
Okay.
So, as we all know, the big overarching plot is that there are a prince and his three buddies trying to go ahead and make it to a capital for the prince's wedding.
It is a bachelor party.
Yeah, it is the never-ending bachelor party.
Okay.
Until the car breaks down.
Seriously?
That's how it opens in the demo. The demo opens that the car has broken down and they need to pay $25,000 to fix it. Consequently, there is a bounty out on a dangerous behemoth for $25,000.
Of course.
So that is the plot that goes ahead and hooks the player into learning the basics of the getting used to the characters, the story.
And the combat.
And it opens with a sense of humor?
Yeah.
That is actually funny? Why have I not seen this?
Exactly.
God damn it! I need to go back and watch this. Okay.
Exactly. So, it looks really good. As long as they keep this up for the actual game, and they keep it like this.
You know, I just realized they're kind of doing the same thing they did with Bravely Default. With that demo that they had at the beginning, before the game came out.
Right.
Which,
oh my gosh.
If they actually have a way for you to like transfer stuff from that into the main game?
Well, that's the interesting thing, is because of the way that the story is, you could theoretically pick it up after episode Duske.
Huh.
So, this could be a thing, for all I know.
Oh,
again,
right.
In order to get this, you have... I don't know if you can actually buy it standalone. I do know it comes packaged with Resident Evil Revelations 2.
Okay.
Which is
and
actually...
it also needs to be played on PlayStation 4. Which is...
Yeah, I still need to get a PS4 because I want to play Bloodborne coming out at the end of the month. Damn it.
Now tell me you've at least watched that trailer.
Yes, I have, and I love it.
Yes, you should.
Bloody hell.
Yes,
this is going to be fun.
And from what I've seen, I looked at Vaadi Vidya's kind of review of it. Apparently, this game's much harder than Dark Souls, the original one.
Yeah, Dark Souls and Dark Souls 2, you're a patient warrior. You have to watch and wait for the timing. This one, fuck that noise. If you aren't going in balls to the wall, you're going to get cream.
I believe we've had this, I believe you and I have had this discussion off camera, and this is exactly what I'm talking about as far as what I've wanted. From not just Souls game, but from our campaign for Ravenloft, and that is you cannot win by being defensive. You have to take your balls out every once in a while, and that's what I'm looking forward to in this game.
Yeah, and also I love the idea of dual weapons.
A weapon that transforms in your hands.
That or like for one, you have a sword that comes out. But if you put it back into its sheath and pull out the sheath, it's a giant hammer! There's a rapier that becomes a gun. There's a detachable scythe, which I fucking want.
In principle, these weapons would not work in real life.
Oh,
but they're fun as hell to use in video
games. Exactly, and that's why it's so creative. The weapon design and the new environment just makes it spring to life.
Oh yeah, it's like a...
And then mercilessly murder you.
As watches as your blood splatters everywhere. Also, apparently, if the enemy kills you, it absorbs your blood echoes, as it were.
So you have to kill the enemy in order to progress, instead of just picking it up and running like a scared little girl.
Yeah. You have to kill it. And you'll notice the difference because its eyes glow. And apparently obtaining your soul echoes back actually gives you, like, some added stuff. I forgot what Vadi actually said about it, but, I'm looking forward to this game.
It looks like fun. It's gonna be hard as hell.
Oh, yeah. PS4 for life, bitches.
Until
you have
the PS5 comes out, or the PS Unlimited, whatever comes
it's
next.
It's still better than the Exit Bonner.
Yeah, I still have no reason to get that thing.
Yeah,
nope.
Exactly. It's just a Killer Instinct box to me.
Yeah.
All right, last thing on the roster. Speaking of the Exit Bonner, Shovel Knight.
Shovel Knight is coming to the X-Bone, or is it already here?
No, it's coming to the X-Bone, much like it's coming to the PS4.
Mm-hmm.
So
and like
the PS4. The PS4 got Kratos as an additional random boss fight.
Right. In the Shovel Knight for the X-Bone, you get the Battletoads.
Wait, what?
There's a Battletoads boss fight as for one of the random boss fights to replace the Kratos fight.
Really?
Yep!
So, remind me, what was each of the extra bosses based on?
Okay, so the bosses in the classic one were all high-paid backers.
Oh, okay.
Right? That's what the initial ones were.
The last one was
that was one of the most famous ones because that was funded by the two best friends.
Ah.
Yes.
When they made the deals with Sony and Microsoft, Sony wanted to put one of their own characters in Liu in addition to those bosses.
Well,
for the for the PS4 version. So they put in Kratos.
Why didn't they do that for the Wii U version?
Because the Wii U version was already included as part of the PC Nintendo 3DS release.
Okay.
So the PS4 and the X-Bone were stretch goals.
Okay.
And so when they actually got the money and went to negotiate, Sony and Microsoft both wanted to put one of their characters in for those console exclusives.
Alright, that makes sense.
Again, Kratos got onto the Sony version, and we've seen that trailer already. And for the Xbox, I think it's Zitz that comes out for the Battletoads.
I just want to say one thing about Shovel Knight, Yacht Club, and whatnot.
Yeah.
And that is regarding their attitude towards approaching these games. I would pay money for them to do what they're doing for free. This is unheard of from what I've seen in previous games.
They're giving the DLC for free, for God's sake.
Yes, I would pay money for this. I want them to do more.
I would probably buy the Wii U version. I have the 3DS version. I would probably buy the Wii U version just to give those guys some extra money.
There you go.
There you go.
Like, this is one of the few consoles where I would legitimately buy another copy just to support the developer.
Speaking of which, there's the DLC is coming out in the summer. And what is the first DLC that they were seeing?
It was Plague of Shadows.
Yep.
Which is the Plague Knight campaign for Shovel Knight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We've already talked to death about this one, though. Is there anything new?
Not so much.
Do we have word on the other campaign?
Part of it is the... I did see part of the screenshot. So, a couple of changes. First off, part of the thing that Plague Knight has to do is he has to collect components from rubble that he's destroyed.
Right.
This serves as his method of upgrade mechanics rather than just flat-out gold.
Yeah. And it is interesting. You can apparently some things are rarer than others.
Yeah.
So you're gonna have to. There's gonna be a different element of exploration.
So you're gonna have to blow up everything you see.
Well, that's gonna make it more interesting than before.
Yeah.
Secondly, Plague Knight actually has a double jump.
Yeah.
To circumvent the lack of hopping for Shovel Knight, he has a double jump.
Mm-hmm. There is another reason why he has that though. Plague Knight is actually a slower walker than... Plague Knight is a slower walker than Shovel Knight.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that was
also
a measure. But if you're good at your double jumps, you can get through a level faster.
Yeah, yes. And there's also, obviously his standard attack isn't a melee. It's actually a timed potion explosion, much like in his boss fight.
Which brings back some fun memories.
So you're going to have to learn how to time your attacks.
Mm-hmm. So he's a completely different character from Shovel Knight.
Oh, of course he is!
Well, the other thing is that the little gameplay expert they showed him at the beginning of the game in the entry planes.
Huh.
In the entry planes.
Which means he's not starting at his fortress.
Which is odd.
So is this happening after the death of the Enchantress?
Well, that's what's
yet
to be seen. The story still remains muddled up in the air, aside from the fact that Moira, the potions girl, is going to be involved romantically.
Possibly romantically. There's still no telling with this guy.
Guy could just be interested in her for her brain.
Or her boobs.
Air quotes, brain.
Yeah, the other thing, and this is... I'm still wondering about this.
He's short enough that he could basically just go ahead and wrap his arm, go ahead just hug her around the hips, and then just...
Anyway!
between them?
It's a mask. I mean, he can take the mask off, and then he just motorboats those puppies all day.
I've actually wondered what some of these characters look like behind the mask.
As I was trying to say, did you guys notice in the screenshots that Plague Knight's Explodatorium is actually still a playable level?
Which means, I wonder if he's going to fight himself.
What is in there that he has to get past? Because there's still a lock to get to the Tower of Fate.
Yeah.
So
well,
he has to fight something in there.
It's going to be interesting to see.
Yeah.
That would be pretty cool.
All right.
And I'm wondering what all the other Knights of the Order of No Quarter will say about him.
Oh, it's already looking fun as heck. I forget what it was the King Knight says. There was a screenshot. Like,
short person.
No, you backstabbing motherfucker, in paraphrase.
I'm pretty sure you're using the wrong voice. I'm pretty sure you need to be using, like, you short! Like a high-pitched voice like that.
Oh, I gotta try this now. You backstabbing motherfucker!
Yeah, like that.
Okay.
And then I just picture whenever he says silence, it's like, SILENCE! Just like it's cracking.
We are the Knights who say...
Me.
I swear to God, that's more like Propeller Knight's voice, in all fairness.
No, he's...
that's more Propeller Knight. What's coming up on the channel, Zero?
Well, with this spring break, I actually might have a chance to record the Poison Type review. No promises. But for the rest of the week, I will be uploading, since it's spring break for me, I'll be uploading the next three episodes of Dark Souls a little bit later than usual, because Wi-Fi.
Aye.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so other than that, well, there's not much coming up. We're almost done with our recording for Dark Souls, so if you guys have any ideas for what we could let's play next, leave it in the comments.
And we'll see what we can do.
All right, this is Leo Force.
This is Des Zero.
And this is Legend Hunter signing out.
Later, guys.
Ciao.
Ciao.
I say the ciao.
No, you don't say the ciao.
I said the ciao.
Yeah, I said the ciao.
I already said ciao.
No, you do. Shut up.
Ciao.
Damn it!